Oh, no. Hare Rama, 주자랑글기
주제
그 나무기
주제
야 뭐지 이 세계는
저
Can I disturb?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I just wanted to let you know that we are broadcasting this whole program on Facebook.
Hare Krishna, everybody, and thank you so much for coming. My name is Shraddhadev Dasi, and that's my husband, Rakesh Prabhu, behind the camera, broadcasting this on Facebook. And Hare Krishna to all the online viewers who are watching the program. So we'll start with a round of introductions. So you can tell us your name.
Bindu, I'm from South San Francisco.
Hare Krishna, Bindu.
Diti from San Diego.
Hare Krishna, my name is Piyush, I'm from Pasta City.
Hare Krishna, I'm Neil, I'm from me.
Hare Krishna, I'm Mansi Suyash, I'm from Dali City.
Hare Krishna, I'm Mansi, I'm from
Dali
City.
Hare Krishna, I'm Archana, I'm from Edu Shores.
And who are you?
I'm from
Edu Shores. I didn't hear that.
Anya, a bit louder.
I'm Anya.
Anya?
Anya. Okay, good.
Welcome, Anya.
Hare Krishna, I'm Khyati, I'm from
Nidre.
I'm Nithya
Priya,
I'm
from
San Mateo.
I'm Makarana, I'm from San Mateo as well.
Alright, good. So we'll do
from
here.
Post.
So we will do our the routine that we do. So today we have chapter 13, different religions and one God. And before I go there, are there any pending questions or anything that's from the previous chapter that we did? Does anybody remember what we did last time? I mean, you were excused, you didn't, you Suresh and Mansi were not there.
Yeah, yeah. Even session,
yeah. So that's why we have it on Facebook, so I didn't even
it's a yoga ladder, right?
Yeah. We talked about the yoga ladder, right? And what were the rungs on the yoga ladder that we talked about?
First one was
Kali Yoga, yes.
Dhyan
Yoga.
Dhyan Yoga.
Dhyan Yoga. Dhyan Yoga.
Dhyan
Yoga.
Okay.
And on the top we
had Dhyan Yoga. But that's the part of the process, right? If you know Bhakti Yoga, then the remaining.
Yes, you get
you
a
may
byproduct.
Understand.
Yeah.
I just need the answer.
So we can either take the rungs and get yoga means to get connected, so either we can go through the rungs and get connected with the Lord, or we can take the elevator or come to yoga and go straight there. So you don't have to necessarily go through all the process steps. So are we ready to go to the next chapter? Okay, good. So I will start from start from you. If we can each read a paragraph. Each.
Many times the seeker of the truth is troubled by perplexing questions. Common sense says that there can be only one God. Then why are there so many religions, so many scriptures, and so many gods mentioned in them? And whom should I follow? Which is the perfect path back to the kingdom of God?
actually God is one, therefore all scriptures being the word of that one God teach the same truth in essence. But God gives his message directly or through his messenger according to the capacity of the individuals who receive it.
For example, in elementary school mathematics, a child is taught basic addition and subtraction, such as 5 minus 2 equals 3. But if he asked, what is 2 minus 5 equals question mark, he will say that it is not possible to subtract a bigger number from a smaller number. But when he goes to high school, he learns 2 minus 5 equals negative 3. That is also mathematics. When he goes to university, he learns differential calculus, integral calculus, etc., which is also mathematics. Although the knowledge he has acquired at each level comes under the subject of mathematics, still there is a difference in the standard between elementary school math and MS math. The teacher may himself be a PhD in math, but he teaches according to the level of the understanding of the student, depending on whether he is in elementary, high school, or college.
So different religions teach according to time, place, circumstance, and the audience. Even though the audiences were of different quality for all these great religions, the message in essence was the same.
God is one. Every living being has an eternal relationship with God. Primarily, the duty of everyone is to serve God. Goal of human form of life is to develop love of God. Love of God can be achieved by chanting the holy names of God.
Bible. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10:13. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Quran. Call upon Allah or call upon Rahman. By whatever name you call upon him, it is well. For him belong the most beautiful names. Vedas. In this darkened age of Kali, the only means of deliverance is to chant the holy names of Hari. Holy names of Hari. Holy names of Hari. There is no other way. No other way. No other way.
Yet there are apparent differences in the words of different scriptures. Why is this so? Let us try to understand this with an example. We have a pocket dictionary and a big bulky Chambers dictionary. Just as small words like come, go, eat, etc. can be found in both the pocket and the Chambers dictionary. Similarly, basic instructions in the mode of goodness like do not steal, love everyone, forgive your enemy, always do good to others may be found in all religious scriptures. And just as big words like cataclysm, corroborate, will not be found in the pocket dictionary, but can be found only in the Chambers dictionary. Similarly, instructions in the mode of pure goodness, like surrender to the will of the Lord out of unmotivated, uninterrupted love. Think of God and serve Him 24 hours a day, and renounce all worldly pleasures and have a desire to serve God birth after birth without desiring even liberation, can be found only in most advanced scriptures. Therefore, authorized religions like Christianity, Islam, etc. are like pocket dictionaries where there is partial revelation of the truth according to the level of audience. And scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam are like Chambers dictionary, which give complete knowledge by knowing which nothing further remains to be known.
Let us examine the audience for these great scriptures of the world. Bible, I have many things to say unto you, but your ears cannot hear them yet. Quran, I received two kinds of knowledge. One of these I taught, but if I had taught them the others, I have taught them the other, it would have broken their heart. Prophet Muhammad, Reincarnation and Islam, Nadar Beg K. Mirza, Madras, 1927. Bhagavad Gita, I shall now declare unto you in full this knowledge, both phenomenal and luminous. This being known, nothing further shall remain for you to know. Bhagavad Gita 7.2.
Bhagavad Gita was spoken by Lord Krishna to Arjuna
an individual of spotless character and a product of Vedic civilization at its zenith. Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken by Suta Goswami to the sages of Namasharanya, who were ascetics and dedicated their lives for the welfare of humanity. The Vedic texts are not sectarian Hindu scriptures, as is commonly misunderstood. The Vedic literature is meant for all mankind since time immemorial, whereas the word Hindu has come up only a few centuries ago. The proper term for the teachings of Vedic scriptures, as mentioned in these scriptures themselves, is Sanatan Dharma, the eternal and universal religion, which is not limited by time, place, and circumstance.
Sanatan Dharma does not refer to any sectarian process of religion. Sanatan means that which is neither beginning nor end. It is the eternal function of the eternal living entities in relationship with the eternal Supreme Lord. Sanatan Dharma refers to the eternal occupation of the living entity.
The word religion conveys the idea of faith, and faith may change. One may have faith in a particular process, and he may change his faith and adopt another. But Sanatan Dharma refers to that activity which cannot be changed. For instance, liquidity cannot be taken away from water, nor can heat and light be taken away from the fire. Sugar and sweetness, salt and saltiness cannot be separated. Similarly, the internal function of the eternal living entity, which is to love and serve God, cannot be taken from the living entity. Those belonging to some sectarian faith will wrongly consider that Sanatan Dharma is also sectarian. But if we go deeply into the matter and consider it scientifically, we will see that Sanatan Dharma is the business of all people of the world, nay, of all the living entities of the universe.
Srila Prabhupada says, the test of any scripture is how one is developing the love of God. If you find that by following some religious principles, you're developing your love of God, then it is perfect. It doesn't matter whether it is the Bible or the Quran or the Bhagavad Gita.
So let's share our thoughts and reflections. And there's certain points I wanted to highlight, but I'll do that later. So anything, yeah, just go through your pages and let's talk about anything that's stuck to your mind.
One question that definitely emerged in my mind was, so there is Quran mentioned in Bible. Are there like any scriptures equivalent to Bhagavatam in other religions which we don't know or maybe they exist? So while there was a comparison made to pocket dictionary, but because we don't know whether there are bigger scriptures there.
Yeah, you're asking if the Muslim religion and the Christian religion have a Chambers dictionary.
Something
like that. Like that's what you're asking. Not to my knowledge, we have never heard of them or talking anything like that. The only thing that I have heard is that that the Bible and the Quran that we see right now have been damaged, the books have been damaged, chapters have been removed and things like that. So, which could relate to what Muhammad was also saying there, right? There were two types of knowledge, he said, that I learned two types of knowledge. So prophet is a prophet, prophet is not God, right?
Yeah.
So his prophet would be something very close to what we call here as Satya Vesh Avatar. So they're incarnations of the Lord. And so either the Lord himself comes or expands and when he comes, or he empowers some souls like us to be able to do extraordinary activities. For example, Narad Muni, he is a Shakti Vaishnava. And Jesus Christ, we consider him to be a Shakti Vaishnava, Prophet Muhammad, like that. So because he is a Jiva soul, so he has to learn that information from someplace else. And usually God gives them the instruction. So what are the different ways in which God can instruct you? What are the different ways in which God can give you instructions?
From scripture.
From the scripture. Right?
Experience.
From experience. Wow.
Realization.
Yeah.
From his own example.
So from outside, he gives you the scriptures. Does he give you from inside also?
From spiritual master.
From the spiritual master.
From his own incarnations.
From his own incarnations. Yeah.
From what? Super soul.
From the super soul. Exactly.
From his own
from
lila.
Inside. Yeah. From his lilas. Right. So there are so many ways that he can instruct. So Prophet Muhammad is saying here that, you know, I have learned two types of knowledge and information, right? He gathered two types of information, but he's saying that I have given you only one.
So you will also see, so he's a guru of those who were following the Mohammedan religion. And so he, but the guru always knows the capacity of the student. He knows that how much can you tell, how much he'll be able to digest, how much will he be able to appreciate, and how much will confuse him beyond repair. So he will only give you that much. And so that's what he did there, he says. So that maybe there is a Bhagavatam, and there has to be a Bhagavatam, right? But then the thing is that they are all different paths. And one thing to keep in mind is that you could be a Mohammedan in this life, and then you could be reborn as a Hindu in the next one. So it's like, you know, passing different grades according to the capacity. So if you are in, like, you know, you only handle natural numbers, you don't understand negative numbers and things like that, then in this lifetime you are in that grade. But then having understood that, then you get ready for the next grade. Now you can handle integers and negative numbers and things like that. So it's very common for a soul to be born in, you know, in a, with one religion in one life, another religion in another life. And that's what this entire text is emphasizing, that there's a difference between religion as we speak, and religion will have, you know, dogmas, do's and don'ts, and some scriptures and things like that, right? But then he's talking about them, that, but what is it which is the nature or dharma of the soul? And dharma is something that cannot change. So there were examples that they gave, two examples that they gave about how you can't change the dharma. Does anybody remember what were those?
You
cannot remove liquidity from water. And what else?
Sweetness from
the sugar.
Saltiness from salt.
Say that again.
Saltiness from salt.
Saltiness from salt, yeah. For some reason, I'm not able to see Suyash Prabhu from here, from my vantage point. Maybe I need to move a little bit. See. Yeah. I need to make eye contact. Okay, so. So he's talking about dharmas which cannot change, because he's giving an example that forget about different religions, even in your one life, forget about different lifetimes, even in one lifetime you can change religion. You can get married and you can change the religion. That's a very common way people do. And I've seen that a lot here in America when I go up to doing book distribution door to door, and I find some you know, white bodied local people here. And so they are like, oh yeah, I'm studying Buddhism, and before that I was pursuing this and I was pursuing that. So they're seekers of truth, they're trying to find the truth. And why they're moving from one truth to another is that they are at a higher level. So when they go to a lower religion, then they're not, that doesn't satisfy them. So the ultimate satisfaction comes when you get to know the ultimate truth. So they are at a different grade. For example, if you are eighth grade student and I put you in a second grade, you'd be bored to death, right? From what the teacher is teaching. So that's why they don't know where to go, because they don't, and that's what brings in the importance of a guru. And the good fortune to have a guru to tell you. So without a teacher, you'll be groping in the dark. Right? Is this right? Is that right? So it's going to take you a long time. But then we should not despair too much, because when Krishna sees the desire in you, then he'll also guide you from inside. So it's not that he's completely abandoned you and you go figure out and you don't have a guru and things like that. So you know, in the second grade, so there is English reader 1, right? When you go to the third grade, there's English reader 2. So similarly, you know, you'll have the Quran. And that's it. That's your capacity, and that's all I'm going to tell you. Because he's saying, if I tell you something else, it'll break your heart. If I tell you ultimately that you know, you have to become a vegetarian, it'll break your heart right now, because you have that desire. So we're telling you, okay, take to this religion and do that. And so while talking about different kinds of religion, so we know from our, so just be happy that you are here. This means that you've done all those lower grades of education, you've done all that. And when we come to the you know, Sanatana Dharma, which is eternal Dharma, so he's talking about the religions can change, and a person can change it over lifetime and between lifetimes and things like that. But he's then saying, but so we have to find out something which is permanent, which does not change. And so what is that basic thing about the soul, which is the dharma of the soul? And he's saying that dharma of the soul is to do loving, devotional service to the Lord, loving service. That's the key point there, is that service has to be loving, right? So now you all have come back from work. Today is a working day. How many of you did loving service then? Do you do it because of love for boss? I love this company like that, you know? We don't love our company. Somebody else is going to give us a higher, better pay packet, you know, we just go there and we just say, well, what was it I signed? Oh, two weeks notice? Okay, here's the 2 weeks notice. Or no notice, even better. Yeah, I just go there. And somebody else offers you a good job, and it's okay to do that, because it's a different world where we are operating.
But what I'm trying to emphasize is that it's not loving devotional service. Love is very different. If you want to see an example of love, then you have to see the love of a mother for a child. That is selfless love. She doesn't get anything from the child, you know. The child keeps her awake all the night, and you know, they'll have stomach upset and they'll cry, and you know, she'll be sleepless, but still she does it without expecting anything in return. So that is, you know, devotional, an example of devotional service. Pure loving devotional service is the nature of the soul, and that is what we do. And because we all have got this service instinct in us, to do service, you will see that we do service all the time. We might not be serving Krishna, but we do serve. So do you have some examples? Some examples come to your mind of how you serve in your day-to-day life?
We serve
the
material world, right?
We serve the material world, yes. And give us some concrete examples of how you serve the material world.
Doing
a
job.
You okay? So you serve the boss, okay?
Doing mundane talks and all, you know, gossiping and all.
Okay, but what service are you doing?
No, I'm just
serving
our
senses.
Serving Maya, not.
You're serving Maya.
Yeah.
Okay.
Serving the untamed senses.
Serving our senses, oh boy, yeah, that's a 24/7 job.
Yeah, but
yeah,
there's
sense,
an untamed.
Yeah.
We are not directing
sense gratification. Yeah. But give me some seva, some good examples of seva.
Today I'm doing some good service, I'm here.
You are here? Okay, very good.
So
yes. And this is not a mundane service, this is transcendental. Yeah.
We have to even donate for charity.
Even donating for charity is some sort of a service. Yeah.
Okay. Volunteering for NGOs.
Volunteering, yes, very good. I mean, wife cooks for the family.
And enabling other devotees to do better service.
Awesome. Like, you know, Kathy Mataji today did service for me. She printed all these. Let's give her a round of applause.
Yeah, thank you.
So we do service all the time, and people serve. For example, the President of the United States, he also serves. Right? The company, they serve their stockholders, shareholders. Right? So everybody is serving, because that is the nature of the soul, to serve. But the thing is that, okay, that all that is fine, but you have to do the ultimate service, and that is the love of God.
Mm-hmm.
So we will teach that to you, and Krishna has made arrangement to teach that to you in different through different grades, through different religions. So you are right now in grade 2, I'll give you English reader 1. And that's it. I will take care of some sort of total of your desires and your capacity and things like that. So this is about the capacity of how much can we digest the rules and the doctrines and the scriptures and things like that. And if you want to go to a higher one, then you know, it might be a different author. You know, like physics. And when you read physics when you're in school, like in high school and all, it's a different writer. But when you go to a higher, you know, college, it's a different one. When you go to engineering college, you know, Halliday and Resnick, that's the most common name that is there. So so the books will also change, the authors will also change like that. So, and also I wanted to mention was that that we have the concept of millenniums or yugas. So we start with Satyuga, which is the best of the yugas, and the souls that take birth there are krim, de la krim, you know, they are the best of the souls. And so they have already done, you know, they are like PhD, trying to do PhD in devotional service. And so the atmosphere and the ambience will be according to, you know, to take care of that. For example, if people are doing research work, it's serious business. So if you go and walk into a university and see people doing research, and the room, and you try to compare them with the room in the kindergarten, you see there's a world of a difference there, right? So the ambience is also required. Well, Kathy Mataji disagrees with that. So there is some water cooler talk that goes on there. At least nobody is there in the researcher's room that is saying that A for apple, B for apple. So the ambience is also different. There's a little more seriousness when you go to a higher education system. So similarly here also. So, and then things start degrading as you go through the various millenniums through Treta and Dwapar, and then Kali Yuga is like, you know, the lowest of the lowest that is there. And so these kind of other, and then the souls that take birth in these different kinds of yugas are also, you know, geared for that particular yuga. It's not that you have to be qualified to be born in that particular yuga. And so they'll have that necessary background, necessary desire, necessary karma, etc., so that, you know, those things will be fulfilled in that yuga. And if you're not qualified to be in that yuga, you stay in the stomach of Mahavishnu's, you stay there, and then you come out later on. So what I was trying to say was that in the Kali Yuga, most fallen souls come here in the Kali Yuga. But don't feel bad about it. Don't think that you are the most fallen souls, because sometimes others also, but in particular, come during the Kali Yuga. For example, the Devtas, they really want to be born in Kali Yuga for multiple reasons. One is that the lifetime is very short. Devtas, by default, the demigods have a very long lifespan. So if you have a very long lifespan, the chances of making mistakes is also very high, right? And you have to work for a really long time to be able to go back to Godhead. But here in this Kali Yuga, because life is short, it is 100 years right now, and it's going to decrease. Srimad Bhagavatam has predicted it will decrease to 50 years and, you know, even 30 years and things like that. So within a short lifespan of, you know, 100 years or so, you can do devotional service and you can go back. And in Kali Yuga, the devotional service is the easiest devotional service. And you read here, what did they say is the easiest way to do it?
Just
chant the names of the Lord, right? So no taking shower, no, you know, putting money into yagyas and things like that. Just by chanting the names of the Lord, you do that. So it is in this yuga where all varieties of souls, which are, you know, some are, okay, fine, they came here on purpose knowing the goodness of Kali Yuga, but most of them are fallen souls, and you can see that. Right? You can see that happening. So because of that, you will see in Kali Yuga, these multiple varieties of religions also start up. So like, when you look at Kali Yuga, everybody's worshipping Vishnu. Satya Yuga, everybody's worshipping Vishnu. So there's a question of a Quran being there, or, and you have the Abrahamic religions being there. So these are products of the of this Yuga, and it is okay. So now when you understand this thing, that there are different religions, although there is one God, the different religions according to the capacity. So once a person gets the basic there, that okay, so he's a first grader and I'm a high schooler, you know? So then you should be treating them with compassion. You will not make fun of them. Like, we don't make fun of a first grader that he doesn't know. I mean, I remember when my daughter was born, I was a little bit shocked because that was the first small child that I came into very close quarters with. When I was young, very small, my little sister was born, but I didn't have that. You know, I was myself very small. But then as I grew up to be able to observe, my first reaction was like, oh my God, she doesn't know anything. So kids are like that. But that didn't mean that I thought that, you know, okay, fine, I'm an engineer and this and that, and you are nothing. You have more compassion because they don't know, and they had to ask you, she was asking me questions about everything. So they asked me, so you have compassion. So when people are lower than you, you should actually have compassion towards them and not make fun of them. And this is what this is emphasizing, that this is, once you get this information that, so they are according to capacity, and then we can live in harmony with them, and then we try to help them out and not convert them. How will you convert a person who's got a tendency, wants to eat meat, but also wants to worship God? Okay, I've got this nice religion for you, you can do that. Right? So the idea is that if you have got some desires, you have to fulfill those desires. Otherwise, you will keep on thinking about them, and until and unless, you know, you get something much better. So Bhagavad Gita in the second chapter, verse number 59 says, Vishaya vinivartante nir aharasya dehina rasavarjam rasopyasya param dishwa nivartate. So he says that if you force somebody to give up something, then the taste for that thing will still remain. So if I force a person who is a Muslim or a Christian not to eat meat, then they might even show them a gun, they might stop eating meat, but then nobody can stop them from thinking about it or dreaming about eating it, or, you know, like that. So, but when you realize realize something which is of a higher taste, then you will very easily give up the lower taste. For example, you know, you can go and watch any Bollywood movie and you have not seen anything better, so you're good. Like Mr. Frog, who's in the well, he's not seen anything other than the well, so he's happy in the well. But then, you know, once you show him the Pacific Ocean, then it's a totally different thing. Now he wants to come out of the well and not want to go back into the well, knowing the freedom and the vast expanse there. So similarly, you know, when you are there in the well and you have got the desire to stay there and that's what you want to do, then here is the religion for you, and you just do that. If you try to force them, then they will not change. So forcefully trying to do things it doesn't work like that. So and then one of the things, well, any other questions that you have?
I think the best thing I found was this last paragraph. It how one's developing love for God. And it doesn't matter where you learn, but the ultimate truth is the love for God, right?
Exactly. So Krishna Prema, we always say before chanting the mantras, we always say Krishna Prema is the ultimate goal, that's what we want, right? And there are, I come from a Muslim city, I was born in a Muslim city, Aligarh, and I have seen there are very advanced Muslims, I have seen there are very advanced Christians as well. I was educated in a convent school, so I've been close to Christians too. And they were nuns, they have dedicated their lives, right? So they do that. And one of the things that Narada Muni actually teaches in the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam is that he says that if you have a desire, then you slowly feed that desire, then the desire actually becomes even more. It's like fire. You light a little fire here, and then if I keep on pouring little fire lights ghee, right? If I have to start pouring a little ghee into the fire, it will never extinguish the fire, actually, it will just continue to burn. So similarly, when you have got desires and you just give them little like that, then you know it'll continue, the desire will continue with you. But if I take a whole big pot of ghee and just pour it on the fire will be extinguished.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that is what Narada Muni says, that sometimes we will put you in a situation like that where it will say, you want to eat meat? Alright, go and eat all the meat that you like. So after you go through all that, then that desire will go away. So sometimes these religions are like that. And a person has, the soul has to go through that because of the desire. At the center, it is the desire. It is because of our desires we are here. First and foremost, we are in this material world because of the desire that we have to enjoy. Separate from Krishna, that's what we want to do. And Krishna wants us to enjoy with him and serving him, but we don't need to do that. And that's why we're here. So okay, you want to enjoy? I've created this whole playground for you. Try to enjoy. And that's what we have been trying to do since so many lives, millions of lives, that's what we're trying to do. And end up being miserable. Till one day the bulb glowed in our head and we just turn our face to Krishna and we say, okay Krishna, now I surrender. You take care of my life and then he will take care of your life like that. Any other reflections?
Mataji, here it's mentioned that the proper term for the teachings of Vedic scriptures is Sanatana Dharma, which is like universal religion and it is eternal. So it's like Sanatana Dharma only came first, right? Then all these religions, like Christianity, Islam.
Yeah. So what he's saying is, when we talk about Sanatana Dharma, the two words Sanatana is eternal. So eternal means which doesn't have a beginning, or we don't know about the beginning, right? So why is it eternal? Because it's the nature of the soul. And soul is eternal, right? So we don't have a point in time like, okay, Krishna was here and this point in time soul was there. They kind of, when whatever we read from the scripture, they were existing always, both of them. Right? So it becomes eternal. And dharma is the nature. So Sanatana, what he's saying is Sanatana Dharma is to serve God. And so don't look if you look at the religion, then in the religion you will still find that all the religions will have that underlying thing. We have to serve God. Muslims also serve Allah. Christians also serve Jesus or, you know, the Lord. And then of course, you know, the Vaishnavas, they serve Vishnu. Like that. So you will find, so what this text is trying to say is that you look for that underlying connecting thing. And then, you know, in the first page itself it says God is one. All of them say that. And then I grew up, actually, before I came to Prabhupada's book, I grew up with this, that, you know, all other religions might say God is one, but here we have many. Till Prabhupada came and made the distinction between demigods and gods, right? So you know the difference between demigod and God? Okay, so God is one. And in the very opening of this paragraph, it said, of this text, it said, common sense says that there can be only one God. Why? What is that common sense? Why did they say common? Why can't there be no two gods?
Because all the children come from one parent, right? So.
Yeah. Why does it say?
I think what they are trying to refer is one source.
One source?
One God, so it may be everywhere, actually. Can't
see. So let's look, here Parashar Muni comes to our rescue. He coined the term Bhagavan. The camera is on there. So he coined the word Bhagavan, and Bhagavan is actually Bhagyavan, which means to have opulences and be fortunate. And he's describing that who is the most beautiful, right? So when you're talking about most of anything, there is only one that, right? Because if there are two, then it can't be most,
yeah.
Right? Like that. So by definition, he's saying that's why the text is saying that common sense, because the way you have defined God, that good God is one, and we are saying who is the God? Also by the definition, as you were saying, that, okay, so Kathy, you are here, or Titi, you are here, so from where did you come from, your parents, where did they come from, the grandparents, and so on, as you extrapolate, and at some point in time, philosophically, you will say, okay, now I want to go to that point beyond which there was no source. So that is, you come to that one. So there's only one God there. So I wanted to mention that. I was trying to explain something to you last night, like demigods, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So there's only one God, and he's we call him Krishna. And why do we call him Krishna? Because Krishna is a Sanskrit term which means all attractive, right? So because if somebody is very beautiful, your mind gets attracted to a beautiful person. If a person is not beautiful, but a person is a millionaire, billionaire, then our mind goes there. You know, try to understand, know more about that person and things like that. So whenever you're the most of something, the best player, the best of singer, and the mind generally tends to go. So if a person is the best of everything, you can imagine how much more attractive that person will be. And so all attractive is translated into Krishna in Sanskrit. So that's why we call him Krishna. And so Krishna is a pleasure seeker. He's Sat, Chit, and Anand. So he is eternal, he is very knowledgeable, and he is a pleasure seeker. So when you want to have pleasure, there have to be two, right? You can't just go and enjoy by yourself. There has to be an enjoyer, and there has got to be an enjoyed. So he creates all these enjoyed, which is us, the living entities. Mm-hmm. And the only thing which he said was, love me and serve me with love and affection. But in order for us to love him, he also gave us the freedom not to love him. Because love is not something that can be forced. If I just create a robot here, that robot is going to love me, then where is the love? You created that, right? So there has to be given some freedom to that particular entity to be able to make a decision and then come and love you. You can't make anybody love you at one point, or by scheme and by design. So he creates that nice spiritual world, and there everybody is living in harmony. But then because of this freedom that we have, some of the living entities or some of the souls decided that not to serve Krishna, they actually wanted to enjoy themselves. And for them, Krishna said, okay, I'm going to create this entire material world, and you go and try to enjoy it there. And in the process of trying to do that, we learn our lessons, because one of you had said that, right? How does Krishna instruct us? Through the lessons that we learn, through the experiences that we have. So that's his way of teaching. And the idea is that, you know, whatsoever time that's going to take you, but again, go back there. Because Krishna is feeling like a parent who's punishing his child, sort of, you know, setting them straight. So it's very difficult to punish a child because you love the child so much, but you have to do it. So while you're here rotting in this material world, Krishna is also, you know, sort of, you know, feeling bad over there for us. And that is why the moment we take one step toward Krishna, he quickly takes 10 steps towards that. The moment you turn to devotional service, immediately things become, you know, easy for you, you know, like this nice group that Akarnam Prabhu has set up in his home. All these facilities will be made available for you. Now, when this material world is created, you need managers, right? Like in a company, you've got managers, so you need managers to manage who should get rain, whose house should go down in a tornado, which plane should be caught, like that. So he needs managers to manage. Now Krishna likes to play. He's like this owner, super CEO, whatever, he doesn't want to work. So he then appoints these managers. So these managers are nothing but like us. They are people like us. But they are more exalted devotees of Krishna. So Krishna gives them more power. Like even if you go back to your work, I mean, you might have some power. Your manager might have a bit more powers. Your CEO has got more powers to do certain things that certain things you just can't do. For example, if you break your computer, right, you can't just buy another computer and then expense it and let your company pay. But if you break your computer and tell your manager that your computer is broken, the manager can sign and say, okay, you go and buy a computer. So they have got more powers to do certain things. So similarly, these managers are called as demigods, because they seem to be God because doing all these material things. But we have to remember that they are souls like us. They're just more exalted, and they're more, they are devotees of the Lord. The devotees of the Lord who had a desire to manage. So if you keep, like I was saying, that it's your desire that will keep you coming back into this material world. So if you have a desire to
to manage, and the company that you're managing or the team that you're managing is not good enough, you want to expand, then Krishna will hear from your heart, he knows what's going on. And then he might give you, all right, fine, you manage all the rainfall in this planet and that planet and this planet. That's what Indra does, right? So we have that pastime where he sends all those Vedas clouds. So there's Surya Devta, there's Agni Devta. So that's why you see the word Bhagwan and there's the word Devta. Right? So Bhagwan is Krishna and then Devta are the demigods. And they live in opulence, they're very beautiful, their body constructions are different, and we'll talk about that maybe some weeks later.
Okay.
But just to give you a little gist of the
demigods
versus them.
In Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita also is explaining this about Devta, right? It says, when you pray one Devta, Krishna himself says, I let that, to have the person get the faith, I let him get whatever he's praying for to the Devta.
Exactly.
Eventually it comes to me.
Exactly. Very, 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 very good example.
Then, of course, but eventually he says you should do it just for, not for gaining something, but just as for love.
Exactly, because it's very important to have faith. It starts with faith. Devotional service starts with faith. It has to start with faith that there is Krishna, there is God. But then, like I said, the desires are burning inside us. We have to satisfy those. We have to ultimately pour that big key so that the fire gets extinguished in your body. Any other points of discussion? Okay, let's take the questions. Why are there so many religions and so many scriptures? Explain with examples. So what was the key that we learned in this chapter? About why there are so many
different
religions?
Different audience, different kinds. Right?
Yeah, different times, yeah, different scriptures, different mentality.
Mm-hmm.
And different capacity
to
understand, right? Okay. And give some examples. What was the example they gave? I love that example that was given there. The mathematical example.
The
I minus 2 is 3.
Right. Yes.
The level 2 minus 5 is negative 3.
Mm. Negative 3. So some people are not able to understand negative 3. So we don't tell them negative 3. What are the similarities in the teachings of the different scriptures?
God is one,
Yeah, go ahead, give me the third one.
Primarily, the duty of everyone is to serve God. The goal of human form of life is to develop love of God. Love of God can be achieved by chanting the holy names of God.
Of the Lord. Okay, good. What is the meaning of Sanatan Dharma? Can Sanatan Dharma be called a religion?
Cannot be called a religion.
So at a higher level, it kind of means it's sectarian, in that case it's religion, but when you go deeper, it's not religion.
It is not religion. On the top, it might appear that, you know, people from India will say, we are Sanatan Dharmis, but then that Sanatan Dharma is common to all religions, because you just listed God is one, every living being has an inter relationship with God. That is what the Sanatan Dharma is, right? What is my relationship with Krishna? My relationship with Krishna is that I'm an eternal servant of Krishna, right? I'm a Bhritya, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would say. And what do you conclude from this discussion, and how can we apply this knowledge to serve humanity at large? How can we apply, right? Because we have to go back and apply.
Be compassionate with everyone. Recognize everyone is soul.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone has the eternal relation with Krishna.
Yes.
You need to develop love for God.
And they are trying to develop love for God in their own way. Vishya, what is that? Vidya Vinaya Sampanne, Brahmane Gavi Hastini, Shuni Jayavasa Pakisa, Pandita, Samadarshina. So, one who has realized this truth will start seeing the soul in every body, whether it's a Muslim body or a Christian body or a dog or a cat. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you come to that particular level. Okay, Shri Nama Milka. Maybe.
Question I was thinking. Sometimes, you know, certain religions like have different styles of preaching or outreach. Like, you know, I remember when I was in college, like there was a lot of missionary preaching, and there was, you know, Kari Nam that we would do. And And sometimes, you know, people take it in different ways. And based on that, you have a certain concept or idea of that sector of faith or religion, you know, Christianity and whatnot. And like, I mean, I'm just wondering, how do you get past that sometimes, and sort of like, because I would have friends sometimes that would ask, hey, you know, that missionary guy was very strong, pushy, yeah, and then same could be with, you know, Harinam, for example. What do you suggest, like?
Well, our motto is leave everyone with a good impression. So we don't push, because we read that there's no point in pushing.
Yeah.
Because it has to come from inside, right? And also, I read this and I was very impressed with this. Somebody was saying that those who come into ISKCON, they were in particular talking about ISKCON.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They said they are highly intelligent people. They are not those who take to this and understand Prabhupada's scriptures and realize that there is something really good in them. And change and decide that, you know, they're going to stay there. They are highly intelligent people. So when you're out in the street, you know, intelligent people are fewer in number,
mm-hmm.
right? So don't be disheartened if you find that I did Harinam for so much, so such a long time, and only two took a Bhagavad Gita, because how many do PhD? And how many do high school? It's about the quality and not just the quantity.
Yeah.
And again, Kathy can tell you how difficult it is to do research. It's not the same as second grade. So you have a lot of challenges, you'll feel a lot of challenges, but you should think that Krishna has empowered you. And so all of us that who, you know, are either preaching or getting geared to go and do preaching, because now that you find this nice taste, when you find there's a nice restaurant that is open, Bahamas or whatever, then you will go and try to tell everybody, like, hey, you know what, where we went last weekend, it's very nice, you should try it out. So similar, you're going to say, like, you know, the day you realize the taste of Holy Name, Holy Name, then you want to share it with others. So till such time as, you know, that happens, so you will do that, you will explain, but it will be for a smaller group of people, and it's okay, because you are, again, focusing on the cream de la cream. So if you get only one or two of them, that is good enough. And then also, if the now with this, armed with this knowledge, if the Jehovah Witnesses are very successful in distributing billions of copies of their whatever that Watchtower magazine that is there, you remember that there are billions of people in that level of understanding of the religion. They need it. So now when you see the whole, you have to always see Krishna's master plan. So Krishna's master plan is this, that okay, there are so many 400 fourth graders and, you know, 200 high schoolers, and then finally there'll be two who will go and do the PhD. So then he will find suitable teachers for that. So it is not, and it is difficult in Kali Yuga to do it, but now, so no, you know, and that is a little bit of knowledge is required to understand what is going on around us. Otherwise the mind will keep on telling us different kinds of things, because, you know, senses are absorbing something, we don't understand the complete picture, we just look at it from outside. Having said that, we should not also draw back our efforts and think that, okay, fine, I just do the elite and then two is enough. We should always, if you aim for the moon, then there are chances you will reach the top of a tree. That's how it is in the material world. But always remember that Krishna has chosen you for a particular topic, and if Krishna chose that you go and teach, you know, masters, then so be it, you know, he has given you the qualifications to do that. So we should actually congratulate ourselves and feel happy that we chose this line. It might be difficult, it might not be easy, but it gets difficult everywhere. I mean, when I started my career, I just had to do what I was told to do, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
And if I did what I was told to do, there was accolades, like, she does such a good job. But then 20 years down the line, it was not good enough to do what you're told. You have to think about new things, how you can improve the company, or you have to go and tell the boss that, you know, in that department I see something wrong is going on, and I think I should take this on, and here's what I suggest. It gets more and more difficult, right? Accolades stop coming, and you only get scolded. Like that, this didn't happen, because the managers, what are they doing? They are fighting fires. Right? So, and then you develop a thick skin. That's
yeah.
another thing. But that's how it is. This is what the material world is like that.
Yeah.
But good question. So being pushy, and that's what they're saying, that they said that religion is something that you can change. It's not your nature, right? So while I was driving to pick up my husband, I was listening to Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, and he was talking about how he was talking to people in a college, and he was talking about the various programs. And he said one of the persons was very, very drunk, and the parents were also drunk, and the children were also drunk. And he tried to find out why that happened. So he said there were some politicians, and because the voting season was on, so they brought 3 truckloads of whiskey, and everybody drank. They gave it away for free. So they, of course, people will cast the vote, but then come tomorrow, somebody comes with something better than a whiskey, then they will go there. And that's why people will change their religion all the time, depending on the taste, and let them be, that they are like that. That's why Jesus Christ said, don't cast pearls before the swine. So, Bhagavatam is a pearl, don't cast it before the swine. Yeah. People have to have the necessary qualification to get a Bhagavatam in their home, like that, so.
Makes sense.
Yeah, but good question, yeah. Yeah, thinking, preaching, that's very good. That's what we should all do. So should we do the Naam Amrita?
Yep.
Okay, so you had the Akhanda from, right? Who's, where did we end from the last time? You did it?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Did you She Naam Amrita?
Chanting the holy name is the sum and substance of Sanatana Dharma. In this age of Kali, there are no genuine religious principles. There are only the Vaishnava devotees and the Vaishnavas devotional scriptures. This is the sum and substance of everything.
In this age, a person should not only Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's movement, but should chant the holy names of Hari and Krishna, the Maha Mantra. That is the sum and substance of eternal religion, known as Sanatana Dharma.
In Kali Yuga, Krishna has incarnated as the holy name in order to deliver the sinful who are suffering greatly.
As the Lord in Bhagavad Gita 4.7, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhakti bharata, abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam sajamyaham. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharat, and a predominant rise of irreligion at the time, I descend myself.
In the present age, Kali Yuga, people are very much sinful and are consequently suffering greatly. Therefore, Krishna is incarnated in the form of his name, as found in the Maha Mantra. Hare Krishna,
Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama,
Hare
Hare.
Okay, sharing is the essence. Okay, let's continue on.
Out of compassion for living entities, the sadhu preaches. The symptoms of a sadhu are that he is tolerant, merciful, and friendly to all living entities. He has no enemies, he is peaceful, he abides by the scriptures, and all his characteristics are sublime.
A sadhu, as described above, is a devotee of the Lord. His concern, therefore, is to enlighten people in devotional service to the Lord. That is his mercy. He knows that without devotional service to the Lord, human life is spoiled. A devotee travels all over the country from door to door preaching, be Krishna conscious. Be a devotee of Lord Krishna, don't spoil your life in simply fulfilling your animal propensities. Human life is meant for self-realization or Krishna consciousness. These are the preachings of sadhu. He is not satisfied with his own liberation. He always thinks about others. He is the most compassionate personality towards all the fallen souls. One of his qualifications, therefore, is Karunika, great mercy to the fallen souls. He is merciful because he is the well-wisher of all the living entities. He is not only a well-wisher of a human society, but a well-wisher of animal society as well. It is said here, Sarva Dehinam, which indicates all living entities who have accepted a material body. Not only does the human being have a material body, but other living entities, such as cats and dogs, also have material bodies. The devotee of the Lord is merciful to everyone, the cats, dogs, trees, etc. He treats all living entities in such a way that they can ultimately get salvation from this material entanglement. Bhagavad Gita 3.25.
That is Bhagavatam. Right? So if you see three numbers, like 3.25.21, that is Bhagavatam.
Okay.
Bhagavad Gita is a chapter, 18 chapters, and then the verses inside. And so that will be a clue if you see two dots there, that is not Gita.
Okay.
Yeah. So which is kind of along the lines of what you were asking, your question was, you were asking that question, right? So tolerant, merciful, and friendly. That's why Vaisheshika Prabhu says that always leave with a good impression.
Yeah.
And it is amazing that when we go to, and I'll end with this thought, is that when we go to, every year we go to Los Angeles, the ISKCON Silicon Valley people go to Los Angeles during Rath Yatra in the month of August. So a whole busload of devotees go there, many drive in the cars and go there as well. And we go and distribute books during the Rath Yatra. And the Rath Yatra happens in the worst place in Los Angeles, or maybe on the planet itself. It's like so full of mode of ignorance. And it's on the beach, so you know, beaches themselves are mode of ignorance. And so the chariots go down there because those people never come to the temple, so Jagannath goes there to meet them. And so they come there, and every year we go there, and then there are some Christians who come and stand there, and they are protesting, and they make fun of the cows and things like that.
Really? In Rath Yatra?
In Rath Yatra in Los Angeles?
Yeah. I never noticed the last 2 times.
Yeah.
Whenever
you reach on the street, when you reach on the
cows and
Venice street,
become really wearing clothes of a cow and things like that.
Wow.
And so they say all that, and actually every Monday before we go out on the Yatra, the temple president Swavas Prabhu always tells us, leave with a good impression. Don't fight with those people and things like that. But every time some youngster will get into some and so they have this, you know, they have this big horns, and they speak on that, and they are constantly criticizing Krishna and Leela. For 2 hours they're talking Krishna, this, Krishna, that. So they are taking the holy names of the Lord, but in a different way, but it'll have its effect. But so what happens is that, so they are there blaspheming, and then of course the chariots is going there, and all the devotees are going there, and then you will find the real intelligent and arrogant people, and they are saying, like, they always criticize them, and they say, look at them, you're doing such a beautiful thing, and you're doing, so you're such nice, we hate these people, they should be banished. And so this is what, you know, leaving with a good impression does.
Mm.
Leaving with a good impression. And you know, like, we'd rather be here, do such a wonderful job. So being pushy and, you know, in the long run, it doesn't work.
Mm.
You might be able to, you know, push for some time, and then, yeah, like that.
Mm.
So, next is the most wonderful part of the program, Prasadam honoring prayer. So we'll ask Kanwar.
Mahaprasade Govinde Namo Kamala Veshwe Sapapanya Vatamajan Vishwasya Vidyari Vaira Vidyasa Vishwasya Vidyari Vishwasya Vidyari Vishwasya Vidyari Jivati Lobo Maestavati Kaki Chita Katin Samsare Krishna Bore Dhe Mori Koi Bare Jiva Jore Sapasadha Vidobai Sinamitapau Radha Krishna Ganagam
So while we are waiting for Prasadam to get ready, so I'm just looking at, and I'm so impressed with the participants over here, because you're all so young, and you are in that stage of life. To have taken towards Krishna consciousness is an amazing thing. It's an amazing, amazing thing. And you are the future of this movement. You have to carry this movement forward on your shoulders. And I mean, I started when I was 47,
So already knees are gone and things like that. But when you start so young, it means that you have done enough in your previous birth to have taken to this kind of thing. So you can take a little pat on your backs and continue to do it. You agree, right?
Yeah. I don't want to start in the Facebook. I have so much question.
Okay, so we can look up the Facebook and we can discuss it over. So what I was going to say was that you're so young people, so you should bring in more energy into the room, right? So when you're singing, you sing nicely, right?
Yeah.
But not too loud that the neighbors come. So this is apartment complaint
to the apartment.
This is how you should be. You should be at this level, okay? So I was just thinking that while they're getting the prasadam ready, how about we just go and do this. Jai Krishna Chaitanya. Right? Louder, a little bit, right?
Jai
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita
printouts also, just in case people don't
take
that.
Yeah.